So I'm trying not to damage the dress.
You guys have been doing this part of it longer, much, much longer than you've been, you actually made the movie, I guess.
Yeah, yeah. Made the movie in like 10 weeks or something.
7 week shoot.
And that was 2 years ago.
Yeah, this will be the last of it, I think. We've been traveling with it for 2 years and this, I think LA is the last stop, yeah. Really.
So has it been, that part of it been fun?
Very much so. And I mean, yeah. I don't know, for speaking for myself, or I don't have a lot of experience doing this kind of thing, mm-hmm. but it's, I imagine it's a very different prospect when you're not passionate about the project.
Yeah.
But for this, you know, we all love Loach and we're proud of the movie, so we can talk endlessly about it.
Yeah. If you had to sell a movie you didn't like for 2 years, that could be a bit painful.
Yeah. That's when really good acting is required.
Yeah.
And are you guys basically like the stand-ins for Loach? Is that... He doesn't seem to like to talk a whole lot.
Yeah, well, it's the long haul flights he doesn't really go in for anymore. So anywhere far flung.
He's good at talking. I think he's
Oh, he's a tremendous talker. Yeah, he can talk endlessly.
Yeah, no, he's great. No, he just did an interview. We were at the BFI last week in London, 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
Cillian Murphy interviewed him, and they talked for like an hour, and it was fascinating. It was really great. And Ken, he's really articulate. Obviously, he's a very intelligent man, but it was really, really great to sit and just watch the two of them talking for an hour.
Yeah, and they could have gone on longer, but for the fact they weren't allowed. I mean, it's a platform for Ken to talk about politics, really, and get his political ideas across. Yeah. So he kind of jumps at those opportunities, I'm sure.
So had the politics of the movie translated to other countries as you've traveled around? You were in Cannes and...
Yeah.
Yeah, of course. And in Japan, he's very, very popular, but... The most interesting one, because usually you're talking, you're preaching to the converted, but we were in Slovakia, which was ex-communist, and we had great discussions there because, you know, they're kind of economically doing quite well now, and they considered the movie rather dangerous.
Yeah.
So we're like, what?
It seem like communism is a good thing.
Yeah, and they obviously had a harsh experience of it. So it had a much different, it was just a completely different context there, which made for interesting kind of Q&As.
And what's the politics like at home? Is this a document of history? Does it feel current?
In some ways it feels current.
Yeah.
Just about people coming together to change things within their own community and then the bigger change. You know, we just had a referendum in Ireland for gay marriage. And that was really about people coming together on the internet. It was a massive social media campaign where it was all just people coming together and changing the legal systems.
And I guess the kind of climate you see, the political climate you see in Jimmy's Hall, very much mirrors what we have today in Ireland and the UK. Mm. And it's, you know, I think what Paul and Ken are always interested in is exploring how civil rights are constantly being eroded, so it's a constant battle, and the world needs people like Jimmy Grattan the Noon and free thinkers all the time, and the same political system that was in place then still presides today.
So is it just that the human nature willed out on this vote, do you think, or...?
The human nature willed out on what vote?
On the marriage vote, the gay marriage vote?
It did.
Vote,
yes, yeah.
It went through.
Well, it had been implemented in other countries. Gay marriages were just ushered in. Yeah, it's fine.
But it's
why
the
not?
First country to ever do it by popular vote.
Yeah,
so
they had a referendum. Let's put it to the people.
Yeah.
And it was kind of, there was such a buzz, really, wasn't there?
Yeah.
It felt like a foregone conclusion. But then you've got people who aren't too proudly conservative, who wouldn't really, you know, they wouldn't be vociferous about it, but you knew there were no voters.
Shy voters.
The place.
Shy noise.
But thankfully it was quite a comprehensive victory, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was a bit of a landslide.
And great
really.
Celebrations. Dublin turned into, you know, gay capital for the day. It was amazing.
Well, we're waiting for the St. Patrick's Day parade in New York next year to see it really all come together.
Yeah.
The combination of the gay parade and the St. Patrick's Day parade, I'm sure will be fascinating.
Yeah,
it would be great.
It's quite a scene.
Yeah.
But I mean, amazing. That's the thing, is it feels like Ireland... There's still this kind of like the old school, this old thing, and then there's this, you know, progressive thinking that pops up every once in a while in a very aggressive way.
It's interesting in that respect. I'm sure Italy and Spain are quite similar. They're just really staunchly Catholic countries, so there's that, you know, that those powers don't cede easily. There's a period of, it's kind of a battleground of sorts, you know. And you win some and you lose some. But it looks like we're heading in the right direction.
Yeah.
So do you get a phone call to be in a Ken Loach film, or do you go and audition?
You get a phone call to say, do you want to meet Ken Loach? And you say yes. And then you meet him, and the first time you meet Ken, you just talk to him for a few minutes, 5 minutes, it was really short. Mm-hmm. And he just gets a sense of who you are, what you're like, where you're from. Mm. And then the next time you meet him, you start doing improvisations. And that goes on for a few weeks, really. Like, I met him about four or five different days.
Yeah.
And you just improvise with a lot of different people, and eventually he finds his gang.
A lot of kind of group improv scenes, and not entirely unrelated to the script, but not scenes from the script.
Right.
No, you never get the script. You know, you never get handed the script ever.
You never ever get handed the script.
No.
The day before shooting a scene, you
get a couple of pages.
So it's a Woody Allen situation.
Does he do that?
Some people say yes, and some people say no. Some of his lead actors will get the full script eventually. Yeah. But he's usually pretty persnickety about who's seeing what.
Well, this is less about that and more about because Ken shoots in sequence. He doesn't want your character to know their own future, you know. So all you need to know when you go into the day is what your past is. And we do a lot of research before we start filming to figure out, and a lot of improvisations between us in those rehearsals that never make it to the movie, but just so that we get a sense of the conversations that we had, so that later on in the movie, you know, we have this shared history.
Mm. And it's super exciting. When you finish a day of shooting and then you've got a brown envelope with tomorrow's scenes in it, so you're straight home to the hotel room.
And he might have 2 pages for tomorrow, and I might have 2 pages, but a big block of it has been cut out.
Yeah.
So that I don't see what's happening in that half a page, because it's going to be a surprise, you know. Right. So that can.
Yeah, and I wouldn't necessarily see Simone's scenes, so she'd have a bunch of stuff.
You're not allowed to share
own.
Your pages with each other.
Yeah.
So do you ever find out, or do you have to wait till the movie?
Wait till the movie comes out. Yeah.
But by the end of the movie, you've filmed it all, so you know what the movie is. But
But it's hilarious. It means a kind of something like a paranoia sets in, because you're constantly second guessing and you're constantly, what's going to happen.
Yeah.
So I thought I was going to get a trip to New York out of it, because the one thing we did know was that this character, as true to life, was
ends
deported
up in New York. Right.
and died in New York. So when they asked for my passport and measurements, I was thinking, we're off to New York.
Did they?
Yeah, at the beginning, yeah.
Cheeky.
Yeah.
So do you think they rewrote you so they didn't have to travel to New York?
Do you think they what?
They rewrote you?
Yeah.
Sometime in production?
Yeah.
Couldn't afford the trip anymore?
They thought it'd be too dangerous to bring him to New York.
Yeah.
Have you, either of you, spent a lot of time in New York and or Los Angeles?
Yeah. I did a couple of plays in New York. Both of us have done a lot of theatre. So I did a couple of plays there. I've been to LA just once before. But it's nice to be back because the weather is so nice.
Yeah, I've spent quite a bit of time in New York. Shot a movie in Long Island, and we had a couple of weeks in Manhattan. So I go back and visit the crew. And we were both there recently for Tribeca.
Yeah.
And LA, I've just visited for just to hang out with mates, and I went to a film premiere.
So do you want to like be Hollywood actors? Is that on your radar at all?
What does it entail?
Yeah, how much are you paying?
I don't have a check today, but
let's take it movie by movie and see.
It's all about the work, really. You know, and there are a lot of good scripts here, and there are a lot of good movie makers here.
A lot of good television over here as well.
It's great
some
TV.
Really good TV.
So yeah, you kind of go where the work goes. I'm not so sure about coming here to look for work, but I would definitely take if the opportunity arose to work here. I'd love to. Yeah,
but celebrity is not a big draw or career building?
No, that's not a noble ambition, really. I don't know.
It's sort of a means to an end, I think, for a lot of people. Is you know, more and more films and TV are being cast by who has the biggest media profile or who has the most followers on Twitter, and so in a way, it sort of feels like you have to be part of that because you want to work. Mm. Which is quite sad because it doesn't suit everybody. Some people love that stuff, and more of us find it a bit painful.
But at the same time, then, if you kind of play that game, you attract a certain kind of work. There's something to be said for the likes of Killian, for instance, a mutual friend of ours who was in Ken Loach's Win the Shakes the Barley, Killian Murphy, and a few friends of mine, Toby and stuff. They play it well. They keep a low profile and maintain an air of mystery, and then that attracts a certain type of work, and they get to work with really interesting people who aren't into celebrity status, you know.
Like Ken.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Loach is the
good. So Killian's certainly been in some big Hollywood movies.
And he does a great job of remaining anonymous at the same time. You know, he does it very well.
Unrecognizable.
Yeah.
Though in this case, you're the leading man. You don't, you know.
Yeah.
You have to be up there with a big smile and the leading lady.
Yeah, Barry doesn't smile.
You don't get to smile ever in the movie?
You smile a few times.
You smirk maybe a little bit.
Yeah.
So why did you guys become actors? What was the...
I was street cast as a 13-year-old kid, plucked from obscurity, and underwent a very similar process to how Loach works, actually. And that was like 20-odd years ago. It was a Michael Winterbottom mini-series for BBC, and it was social realism. So it was very much in the, you know, Ken Loach style of filmmaking. So I've been doing it since then. It was never a desire before then, you know.
So did somebody just come up to you in the street and go, hey, you should be an actor?
Well, they were visiting, they were rounding up boys, young lads from school.
Rounding up boys, like stray dogs.
They kind of wanted non-actors. They wanted it very real. So they happened to be in our school. And to this day, I'm not entirely sure, but I suspect teachers put forward or nominated certain messers, certain, you know, delinquents. And I was the leader of the pack, so I was... straight in there.
Born to it.
See, I was just right for that part, you know, and that part came at the right time.
Yeah. I was always doing it, I think. Like, I was always doing plays when I was a kid. But in my town in the west of Ireland, there was no youth theatre, there was very few outlets for it. So it wasn't until I was kind of in my late teens, really, that I sort of realised I could do this for a living. I had always wanted to, but really didn't think it was possible. And then I left home and moved to Galway, which was a really great cultural hub at the time. It was in the mid-90s.
To study
art, actually. Right. And then ended up just joining Galway Youth Theatre and doing lots of... So it was kind of progressed as it went along. But there's not really... I mean, that's... Only in Dublin could that have happened, really, that you would be plucked... in Ireland to do a TV or movie. That was never going to happen in the west of Ireland, in my hometown. That just didn't
happen. But for Loach, 20 years later, for Jimmy's Hall.
Yeah.
But then I grew up in Dublin and was living and acting there for until I was like 25. Simone was living there for a few years. But then we both moved to London. Hmm. So we're both living there now, where there are just far more opportunities.
So is that really what the progression is? The tradition in Ireland is
theater. A lot of people stay in Ireland and do theatre and end up doing sort of bits of television and film. I think I got to the point with me where I thought I wanted to do a bit more television and film, and it wasn't really happening in Dublin. I was getting loads of really great theatre, but I had done I'd done 11 years in Dublin where I was doing lots of theatre and I loved it, but it was good to move and to change it up a little bit as well.
Yeah, I mean, film and television is quite a small industry, I think it's fair to say, in Ireland. It's such a small country. So there are a huge number of actors go to London all the time. And then some of them will move on to LA or New York. You know?
Yeah.
But I think in London there seems to be as many Irish actors there as there are in Ireland.
In Dublin, you know? Yeah.
So at home it's like Sheridan or Loach and then you're done?
No, there's a Sheridan few. I mean, there's a few young guys coming up.
There's a lot of talent coming through.
Yeah, there's some really, really good.
Yeah, the guy who made Pilgrim Hill and the new one now, Glassland. His name escapes him, but there's a lot of good young talent coming through. And some good film schools, like in Dunleary and stuff. And you know, and then there's always been good people flying the flag. You know, with Robbie Ryan who shot. Jimmy's Hall, he's doing amazing work as a cinematographer. And you get people like Brendan Gleeson, like these are big international stars. So.
Yeah. Well, they seem to shoot a lot in Ireland these days. Like that seems, I guess there was some sort of funding.
There used to be a handsome tax break. Yeah. That was there in the 90s when we had something of a golden era with Jordan and Sheridan making big Oscar nominations.
I forgot Neil, sorry.
Yeah.
Sorry, Neil Jordan.
And then I think that tax deduction went out the window, so all these companies were going to further east, like Budapest and places like this, to shoot. But it seems like they're coming back to Ireland, and there's a lot of big studios there for TV work now.
Yeah.
A lot of green.
Yeah. A lot of green, but I think
there's a lot of TV happening in Northern Ireland as well, like Game of Thrones and shows like, and we just did a movie together in Belfast called The Truth Commissioner. So there's a lot of stuff happening in Belfast. There seems to be, there must be some funding there as well.
There's a lot of good talent in Belfast as well, film writers and filmmakers.
Yeah. So does it, so you get the phone call, you go in for your stuff, you work through the process. Was the shoot hard in any way, or is it really just, does he keep it that natural that it feels easy once you're doing it?
The latter, they
really set it up so it's conducive to good performance. You really have very little to worry about, and it's quite theatrical, and us having come from a theatre background, most of the scenes he plays out for like 10 minutes at a time.
You get to improvise like your way into the scene, then you do the little bit of dialogue that you've learned, and then you improvise your way out of the scene, and when he cuts it, he cuts a lot of that stuff out, so you end but it flows very naturally. He never says action or cut. You know, he just doesn't use those words. Everything has to feel really like organic, like the conversations come out of another conversation, and
it's very actor friendly.
So is there a lot of research involved with parts like this?
We learned to dance for a couple of months, and then Barry worked on a farm for a little while. And then we did a couple of weeks of like history lectures. This guy Donald came up from Cork, and he was doing history lectures with the main bank of actors joined us then, sort of the group, and a few of the others, and we had history lectures, and we read books and kind of learned, so just so that we would know what the current political climate was at that time, you know, so that we would have that frame of reference. So
And it's unusual in comparison to other jobs, because the script is kept close to their chest. Any research you might want to undertake yourself, you're kind of stabbing in the dark. You're not quite sure where to start. So a lot of it came from them, you know. But without even selling it, they would kind of be like, I think it would be good if you went and worked on the land. You know, and I think you should have calloused hands. So I was offering my services to the locals to do some farm labour. Unbeknownst to me, there's a scene in it when I show Father Sheridan my hands. So I was doing my best to get calloused hands, thinking he was speaking metaphorically, you know.
No, he directs really gently. Like, he'll come up and say like that, might be good if you guys maybe, why don't you go, you know, up that way? And then you realise afterwards the reason he sent you away up for a walk up a road is because he's giving everybody else guns, and we're not supposed to know that everybody else has guns. So when they pull the guns, we're surprised. But he did it really, like, we were walking up the, and I had no idea. I hadn't even thought of it. We were walking up the road, and Barry said, do you think we've been sent up here for a reason? Do you think that maybe they're all being given guns? You put it right on the button. And I was like, oh, they all have guns.
Yeah, but then the lads all come down, like, trying to look innocent, and they've got, like, big AK-47s under their vests, you know.
AK-47 is not real. But, yeah.
Yeah, so there was a lot of secrecy, because he loves that element of surprise, and he wants to capture real reactions on camera. So there was a lot of secrecy, which led to the paranoia. You're just constantly second guessing.
Yeah.
Were our cameras running a lot of the time when you're maybe rehearsing, or you think you're maybe prepping?
I don't know. I'm not sure.
Sorry, what was that again?
Were cameras running kind of secretly while we still thought we were rehearsing?
No, I don't think that ever happened. No.
But I know on Barley, because obviously it was a fully fledged war in The Wind That Shakes the Barley, and these actors had no, they didn't know what was going to happen in the script. So every night after work, they were like depressed on the bus home, thinking, I'm getting killed. My character's getting shot tomorrow. I know it. I'm going to be an out of work actor again. You know.
I had a moment when we were in the hall, and there's what you don't see in the movie is that night when we all dance and the band comes in. We filmed for hours and hours, and we did loads of other things, like Francie got up and sang Sally Gardens. It's beautiful, really lovely. But while he was singing, so we didn't know that was going to happen. He got this noble call. Barry went up on stage and said, come up and sing a song for us. And we were all like, oh, okay, he's going to sing a song, great. So we all kind of gathered around. And then I could see Ken talking to Robbie and getting a couple of people out of the way so that they had a view of me listening to the song. And I thought, oh, my God, I'm going to be noble called to sing a song. And I started to sweat and my heart was going in my chest. I was like, oh, because I had sang, you know, a couple of weeks before when we did the flashbacks, I had done a little bit of singing.
Oh,
and I think I thought, oh, no, now they think that I'm going to be comfortable singing in front of like 150 people.
Which could well have been.
It never happened. But because you have that paranoia, I was sweating.
Could well have been Una's reaction as well, though. Oh, they've called Francie up. No, I'm next.
She leaves the hall. I'm not doing it. I told Ken afterwards and he just laughed at me. I was like, I really thought I've been sweating for the last half an hour.
But it does seem to like really keep you on your toes. I mean, it's brilliant whether it happens or not.
Yeah.
Although why Una's worried listening to Sally Gardens is probably not. I was listening to him singing, just going.
Which because he said to me early on in rehearsals, he was like, while we were all rehearsing and being brought around the hall and just as actors exploring it, he was saying to me, so I think I might get you to, you know, get up and introduce this hall to the people just as a little exercise and talk to the people. And I was thinking, oh, I hate public speaking. I have to get up and speak in front of 40 people. So he was like, maybe prepare a piece on Pierce or Connolly, after whom the hall is named. So I sweated over history books writing out this speech. And every time we stepped foot in the hall, I was like, kind of hiding. I'm thinking, he's just going to call me up now. Of course, it was preparation for the speech that I gave in the movie. So in ways, that was me doing the work for that. But
not knowing what
it's for.
Entirely
unknown to me,
So is the speech easier at that point? Is it easier for you to do the speech that was written rather than the speech you wrote?
Much easier. Yeah, somebody else's words. Yeah, it doesn't feel like public speaking. It feels more performing or something, you know?
And do you fear the idea of public speaking?
Oh, I don't like it at all.
As an actor?
Yeah, I don't like public speaking. It's like...
Yeah.
I don't like
unless it's unless like that, it's given to you, and it's a speech that you've learned off, and then you can do
acting.
It. But
that's
if
different.
It's but if it's your own thing, yeah.
Yeah.
So did you develop that separation of the two of who you are versus giving a performance early in your career? Or did you have to figure it out as you went? Did you take classes?
No, you make it up as you go along, and because you think in that instance, it's like Jimmy Galton was a really good public speaker. Right. We know that he had good oration skills. So I was thinking, right, that's the character. That's what I have to do.
But I mean, when you were a kid, was there a moment you figured out, oh, this is not me that I'm giving people as I work?
Yeah, I guess so. Or there's elements of you that you bring to it. But, you know, you're given scenes and you're given clear objectives. It's just a different mindset, you know.
I think I did it when I was a kid. I did a lot of singing. And that was kind of my way into it. I went into musical, you know, amateur musicals then and thing, which singing never really felt like I was public speaking because you're singing a song and it's
a different object. Yeah. It's just a slightly change of mindset or something.
Yeah.
But the first gig I got it wasn't that I was an extremely shy kid or anything, but the first job I got was very much like a Loach environment. It was very natural realism, a lot of improv. And I was playing somebody that wasn't that far removed from myself, you know. So it felt very natural and easy. Mm.
So the film is done. They cut it together. Did you see it before it premiered?
We were in the cutting room a few times, so we got to watch him edit it. He's really open like that. You know, you can come in. And it's not a dark room because it's on the Steinbeck. Mm-hmm. It was the old proper cutting and sellotaping the movie. So we got to watch that, which is probably the last time it's ever going to be done in the UK.
Yeah,
and we got
incredible.
To watch it, which is great. And then we all went to Channel 4 studios. Barry and myself did, and Ken and Paul and a few of the gang from 16 Films. And we got to watch it, but a couple of times they had to restart it. Do you remember? Because it was off
out of sync.
The sound. So we had to go away for a little while and then come back again.
Yeah, but at that point it was because the interviews and the press was starting to kind of take off. So Ken was like, you know, I think you should see the movie before you speak about it. So we were like, that seems like a sound idea. So we did get a screener in a small cinema with about 20 people.
Yeah.
Like about a month before Cannes, I guess.
So what was it like for you? I mean, I'm curious about the cutting room thing.
Yeah.
I mean, have you had other circumstances in which people invited you into their
cutting room? No, never. Nobody, no, actors don't generally get invited into the editing suite.
Yeah.
But so when Ken offered, I thought that he was just being polite and he didn't really mean it. And then he said it again. And I said, are you serious? We can come in and watch you cut the film. He said, yeah, come on in if you're in town. So I went in a few times. I brought my baby in. So I have a little video of my baby watching Ken cut on the steambook with Jonathan, and I'm like, that's a little moment in history, because that's not going to be done again. And it's in a bright, airy room. It's not in a dark room. So I brought them in some, I made them some scones and jam and things, and they were delighted.
It was just great to see that big old clunky machine with proper razor blades.
This tiny little screen. They
and
cut it on
sellotape.
This little,
it's so old school.
Yeah,
on a tiny monitor.
So are you self-conscious watching them cut you, or?
I wasn't, you know.
No, I didn't. I don't think they cut anything that I was in. I saw them cutting stuff that you were in and saying how terrible you were.
Cutting the floor.
They didn't cut anything. But then they would show me. They'd say, do you want to see something that we cut together? And they'd show me a couple of scenes that I was in. The only other time you get to see something is when you do ADR. That's the only time you get to watch something before.
I wasn't nervous of watching it all, were you?
No, because I kind of feel like the process that we had making the movie, I sort of knew what movie it was. I knew that Ken wasn't going to mess around with it too much. Mm. Like, even being in the cutting room with him, he usually uses the first take because... And he said to me, you know, he showed me a take of Barry's, like, and it was when Barry comes out of the hall and the gang are waiting for him by the bridge and he realises, OK, I'm going to open the hall again. He showed it to me a few times and he said, which... I said, well, maybe like the third or fourth. And he was like, why? And I was like, well, it just gets more polished. And he was like, and that's why we're not going to use it. You know, we're going to use the first one because it's less polished. You know, he makes a mistake when he's opening the door. He can't quite open it properly. He has to push it. Well, Barry had that figured out by the fourth time and was opening the door fine. And it was, like, you know, so these are the little things that Ken does that makes it more authentic.
Yeah. Even when we did see the first screening then, when they showed us in that little cinema, it was still... incomplete. They were having this massive debate about the dance scene, the scene we dance in the moonlight, and it was over whether to include music or not. And there was a beautiful piece of music written for it, but they were kind of adamant that the scene stood on its own 2 feet without the aid of any kind of a bed of music, and that was ongoing. I think that went on for another few
weeks. Up until before Cannes. And the reason that he put the music in, I think, was when he was talking to the guys in Cannes. It's a massive theatre that it gets shown in there. And without the music, it just might have been a little bit too quiet.
Is that what he was saying?
Yeah. And there was no... There was if you had left music out of the movie for such a long time, when it comes back in again, it would be too much.
Yeah.
That you need to sort of drip it in every now and then so that it's...
Yeah.
So was Cannes nerve-wracking for you guys?
Or is it kind of fun, just fun really? To go...
Oh, Cannes, sorry.
Yeah.
We didn't really know what it was. Neither of us had been to Cannes in that capacity before.
Yeah.
And the red carpet is actually, when you're with Ken and Rebecca, who've done this loads of times, they're so chilled out that really you just...
Well, the red carpet was the most chilled out part of it because you have 5 minutes to walk 20 yards and you get to chat with your mates finally.
Yeah.
Whereas before that, you were kind of cordoned off with paparazzi everywhere. And that was I found it a little intrusive and nerve-wracking. I felt like in that first big press conference, I was so nervous. I didn't open my mouth. But it felt like I was an international drug smuggler who'd been caught.
It was a lot of flashes.
Interrogation.
Yourself.
Yeah, it was horrendous. I didn't like it. But it was great to be there with Ken and Paul, who were so articulate and passionate, and just to listen to them.
And did you guys watch the film, I assume, with the audience?
Yeah.
How was that experience?
That was magic.
That was great. That was because it was such a big thing. And then they applauded for about 10 minutes. They stood up and applauded for about 10 minutes afterwards. And so finally we were like going, okay, stop. But I mean, it's for Ken, really. They just adore Ken over there, you know.
Yeah.
And they were really...
So it couldn't be for you guys. It wasn't...
Well, it was also the movie, of course. But they loved it. And I think even Ken and Rebecca were surprised at how long they stood for. So that was great.
Yeah, it was a great buzz.
We're thinking, this is going to happen for every movie.
Yeah.
And I assume it's happened every year since. It's now, what, a year, I guess? Just a little bit over a year.
Yeah, Cannes was a year ago. Yeah.
So this is about to end. Do you guys just kind of, does it get filed away and you're on to the next things? I assume you both should have done things since then.
We have both done things since then. And there's a couple of things about to come out that the movie that we just did is going to be out in October. And a TV show, and Barry's done a couple of other movies that have come out since, haven't they?
I've got 8 movies in the can. Two are premiering next month. Yeah. I'm off to the Edinburgh Festival next week. And then the Galway Festival the month after. So a few movies.
I've got 15 movies in the can.
But now you guys are like old press pros. You're like, you know, you've been through the Loach tour.
Yeah.
And you're, you know, ready for anything.
Yeah. It's a good intro into that world, all right.
Person by fire. What's that?
Baptism of fire.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's exactly what it was. Mm. Yeah.
Irish people forget about baptism. It's shocking.
Yeah. How could I do that? I've pushed it out of my mind.
Yeah.